Hello, hi, good evening. Murat, as you were just talking about the past, George Washington University and so on and so forth, some very unexpected stories came to my mind. I don't know if this is an appropriate way of starting the meeting here today, but those years of painting in Washington, D.C. were not so glamorous. Just one instant came to my mind as you were speaking. I remember after the school studies, I was looking for portrait commissions so I could pay my rent. And then there were some numbers of months that I didn't have anything. So pretty pathetic times. But one gentleman asked me if I could paint his wife and their dog. I said, sure, why not? Let's do it. So I met the lovely wife and the dog, and I took a few pictures at the cafe we met. Then I said to myself, I have everything I need. I can go back home and do my painting. Anyway, everything was fine, and I was somewhat content with this work. And when I handed the painting back to him, can't remember his name now. It's not a very good memory, so it's just disappeared, I think. Anyway, so he liked the painting very much. And then his wife also liked the painting. You can visualize this as a vertical canvas, 1 meter and 20 centimeters high, and a lady is sitting in a white dress, and here we have the dog sitting next to her. And I'm not a dog person, I'm not a cat person. I have lots of allergies and stuff, so I don't know much about the dogs. Apparently, the grandmother didn't like the dog. She said, "My daughter looks great, and I like the painting, but this dog is not our dog." So I said, "Yeah, I don't know much about the dog, so I kind of made a generic dog, based on what I was seeing on the photograph." And so they said, "Can you do anything about it?" I said, "Yeah, I mean, I need to get to know your dog so that I could, recognize the facial features a little more, so I could differentiate the portrait of the dog compared to this generic portrait I had." And so they invited me to their house. And I don't forget this moment of sitting in just someone's house with a dog in front of me, and I'm supposed to make sketches of the dog for 45 minutes, 1 hour there. And that moment just stayed here, and it just popped out now when you were talking about what happened in Washington, D.C. Anyway, so finally the dog was repainted on the canvas. And the painting was delivered back, and then I got my money so I could pay my rent. Anyway, I don't have anything particularly prepared. I'm open to having conversations. We could talk all together if you like, for the first 30 minutes at least. Then later on, I will be presenting some of my slides from the musicality and dance lectures I give. But before we get there, we could, if you like, Murat, we could look at some of the videos you prepared and then talk about them and and then let it flow. What do you think?
Which one would you like to start with? Any of them?
I think you just showed something from Budapest, I remember seeing.
This one?
And that was, I think we just watched this, right? Did you just play this?
Yes.
Okay. Hey, by the way, this partner of mine, Sigrid, her last name suggests she is from Netherlands, but she's not, she's French. One of our microphones are on. Oh, I think now it's all taken care of. Great. Yes, so she and I are no longer dancing together, but we had a nice 5, 6 years of working together. And in this video, we are in Catania, Italy. And the song we're dancing was suggested by a friend in Sweden. Apparently, it's a Swedish band. And so we listened to it and we liked it very much, even though it's not a tango song. It's an alternative tango song, we call them. And sometimes in the festivals that we go and work, we perform one alternative dance after dancing two tangos and one or two waltz. And then if we have the fourth or the fifth, if people like it and if they want to have us back on stage, we do the last dance as an alternative dance. And this video is one of those, apparently. So if you like, we could just take a look at this. Murat'cığım. Okay, we should probably put this on the side now, Murat. Mm-hmm. Great, hey, it's nice to see these old videos. This is a town in the island of Sicily, Catania, in south of Italy. And the organization in this island is an exceptional person because, you know, we all have some ideas about the Sicilians, you know, from the movies. But this man is a complete the opposite. I can see him right there behind the laptop with his hand on his chin. His name is Angelo, and he is an angel indeed. And throughout the pandemic, when we were all in big trouble, the dancers and the teachers, he was one of the greatest supporters, and both financially, he was able to support the festival teachers through Patreon accounts, and he made sure that he organizes the event this August coming up, and he invited us again, so we will be there back to Catania. It's a very meaningful person for me to make sure that I don't skip working with. Good, so this is an alternative dance we just watched. The gestures are somehow tango-esque. We borrow some elements from tango dancing and then some other elements from modern dancing and combine them together to dance. Murat, should we look at something else or do you have any questions? Would you like to conduct us?
I think we should move on your slides, Murat.
Should we do that?
Yes.
Very good. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that is going to be me sharing my screen in this case. My friends, I will be showing you some of the slides from my musicality lecture, and I didn't want to bore you the entire hour only talking about the music. So I decided that I would pick up a few of the elements from the most studied, most known musical elements that we typically teach when we teach the theory of music. And the ones that I picked today are going to be the rhythm, melody, and form. By the way, speaking of melody, I am absolutely in love with this particular element of the music, because most of the times dancers spend the majority of their attention to rhythm. And but the melody, it comes to your dancing one day and you realize that there is a, you know, incredible amount of possibilities. There's just unfolding from there. So I'm going to go through them quickly a little bit. Beat is a basic unit of time. This is how I like to usually introduce it to my students, where it's like a black little box and it sounds like that. I don't know if that was too loud for you, but we'll arrange this. And beat is a pulse. And it plays a strong role in the dance as well as in the music. So when these guys get together next to each other, they create a timeline. And during the timeline, then you start to recognize that there is a duration, you know, things are just starting to happen in a particular length of time. And for some of us dancers, this is good enough to dance to. It's just a number of beats coming next to each other to create a very simple rhythm. It gives you the groove and you may start to, you know, move to it. Of course, most of the times we also hear something, we call it upbeat, and that's most of the times come from the conductor's hand gesture, and it sounds like this. Down, up, down, up. And that's with super simplification that I'm of course doing here so far. And in reality, the rhythm that we know in most of the music come to us in much more complex ways. I wonder if it's possible to hear any trace of melody in whatever we just heard now. It is completely percussive indeed, but even in drums that you could stretch the letter on the drums to actually create different tones. So this is slowly bringing us to the need of the melody. So, but before we do that, particularly in the tango music, the rhythm is played by melodic instruments such as contrabass, stand-up bass, some of us know it. And this instrument is a string instrument, yet you can actually pluck the strings and make the instrument to sound much more percussive than it is. So it is a typical thing in a tango orchestra. Most of the instruments are melodic instruments. There is no percussion and there are no drums in a tango orchestra. The closest perhaps we can come to a percussion will be piano. No matter, piano is also a very string-oriented instrument. But if you open the piano and look at it, you will see small hammers. They're actually hitting these strings. So there's something percussive about it when it comes to piano. And in the tango music, piano is usually creating the rhythmic elements. But there are 88 keys, right, on the piano. So you can actually create lots of notes and lots of melodic lines, a little bit like pixelated. I don't know if you know what I mean. So in the tango music also, it's not that simple. There are these downbeats, upbeats, and syncopations and everything. It's quite rich. All right, I move on to my favorite element. I love so much that I actually named my newborn baby. My daughter is named Melody, without the Y, with IE, because my wife is German, so we thought we would stick with the German version of it. Here in the German side of Switzerland, in Zurich, she's gonna have an easier time, I think. Flowing combination of pitch and rhythm as a single entity. You all know what melody is, but I like to make these visualization, and as Murat was describing previously, it's something that I enjoy doing very much, is to describe things like music or movement visually to illustrate. And that's why I put these rhythmic blocks underneath with the down and upbeat, and it seems like the melody in blue seems to be laying over like a blanket. It sounds like this. By the way, I don't know if you agree, in today's music, today's contemporary music, the melody is going weaker and weaker. The new orchestras, they tend to play very rhythmic and very percussive pieces of music. And so it maybe that was a protest from our family here, that we decided we should teach melody, we should dance with the melody, we should name our baby Melody. Anyway, I move on and I show you a gentleman, Wolfgang Köhler, and this gentleman was a scientist, German-American scientist, and in 1929 he collected a group of people in front of him and simply showed the group these two simple shapes. And then he asked the people, hey, one of these is called Kiki and the other one is called Buba. I wonder if you can tell which one is Kiki and Buba. So since we are here in the Zoom meeting, I still suggest you to raise your hand and point at the screen and tell me which one is Kiki. Show me which one is Kiki. Is it the one on the left or the right?
The star-shaped one is Kiki, right?
Is that true? Is there anybody has a different opinion on this, I wonder? Because according to surveys, 98% of people in the world, they choose the one on the left as Kiki and the one on the right as Buba. Let me explain them a little more. Kiki is... my computer is freezing. Kiki is representing linear and angular corner and sharp lines. And Buba somehow represents more the softer and more round gestures. So, of course, one can say, hey, Kiki looks, you know, and more soft to me than the Buba. I mean, that you never know what these shapes can actually remind the people. I remember meeting a lady in Netherlands once, and she was perfectly round herself, and she was very soft in her body and very relaxed, and her name was Kiki. So, and when I asked her, she said that the Kiki is actually on the right because it looks more feminine to me, she said. Sometimes I ask if you know some people who could be more Kiki, who could be more Buba. Those of you who are sitting next to your spouses right now, you can think which one of you is more Kiki, which one is of you more Buba. Obviously, we all have a little bit of Kiki and a little bit of Buba within ourselves. It's not a good idea to just think that some people are Kiki, some people are Buba. But in general, I think the Kiki is representing more the masculine lines. For example, when you look at the history of art, we're looking, I'm not going to mention the artist's name, no need. I just want you to see the shapes and the colors and the contrasts and the softness versus the contrast and the harshness of the lines, that the feminine body was represented with their circular lines, and right next to her arm, as you can see, the green and red contrast colors, and black and white, the contrast tones in very straight lines, creating that contrast to make her look even more buba, more circular, more round and more soft and more gentle and more organic. And then later on, himself painted his own portrait in the lines of the Kiki. We'll look at a few other things to see if that really applies and how that could work in the music of tango and in the dance. But don't take this very seriously. I think it's perfectly fine to believe that maybe we are looking at the Kikis right now. That's okay. The case that I'm building right now with you assumes these shapes are the buba shapes, because the sound of buba and the shape of buba somehow match each other. Anyway, let me continue. Henri Matisse painted Icarus, and you could see the stars versus organic human body and the heart being a completely circular. So composition of Kiki and Buba in some ways. His son, Pierre-Henri Matisse, painted this, and he signed each corner of the painting. And however you hang, all you see is Kiki and Buba and some more Buba in between. You know who these guys are? I just like your eyes to recognize the star-like shapes or the circular shapes. I looked at the alphabet because Wolfgang Köhler's idea of Kiki and Buba and how those two shapes create somewhat a scale that we could, think of our lives a little bit on that scale or listen to the music within that scale. I believe Kiki and Buba would be staccato and legato in the music, right? As the Kiki could be square and the Buba could be circle. Here we are looking at the alphabet and the way the letters look like, not the way they sound. Some letters are much more angular and some of them are more circular. Is it a complete coincidence, do you think, that the word of tango has a complete perfect proportion of Kiki and Buba in it? Perhaps. So here is a sample from a tango orchestra of the Kiki sounds like. Look, I'm not going to change the orchestra and I'm not going to play another song. I'll play the same song by the same orchestra. Just a few seconds later on in the music, you hear this. So most music are created within these two extreme ends of the scale, like most of the artworks, one can say, are somehow drawn by linear versus circular lines. But the tango music particularly has a really appropriate proportion of the two. Sometimes you hear them together. So I'm going to come out from this and then see how you're doing there, first of all, to see if you're able to follow, if you're getting used to my English, or if you have any questions at this moment, I could take a few questions. And then it's an opportunity also for us to step out from these things we're looking at and somehow try to bring it to our lives. Bring it to our bodies. Do you have any question, any of you?
I have one.
Mm-hmm.
You forgot to tell us how you got into tango and what you have done on tango.
Okay, so that's not so much about the slides that I just showed, right?
Yeah.
Okay, So, but let me try to tie this back to my slides. So it's a good question. So I studied art, painting, but then being Turkish in Washington, D.C., and being an artist, painter, wasn't so easy that I needed to put my hands on to a few other things that I could do. And one of them was dancing tango, because I started dancing tango in Istanbul in 1998. And when I was in New York first and Washington, D.C. in 1999, in 2000, I realized I could actually improve this and offer either sessions of practicing or maybe potentially even teaching some lessons or something if I could, you know, being a kind of an intermediate dancer. But once again, financial needs of the time somehow made me more courageous. So I started to make small flyers with my picture and my telephone number. We barely had an email address at that time. And so so I offered lessons, and I kind of started to earn some money out of dancing tango. And then when that actually started to work better than the making portraits of, as I give the examples, unexpected guests. And so then I realized that maybe I should move in this direction, and I was enjoying very much. I think dancing is a fantastic activity compared to being an artist, where you are alone in your studio, and sometimes you work months and months and months and months, so you can put 12 or 15 paintings together so that you can have an exhibition, and the moment people come and talk to you, you forgot how to speak, being a lonely artist. But then tango dancing comes with someone in the embrace right here, so you're always with someone in the dance, and then you have all the other dancers, and even the time you're not dancing in a typical tango evening, you still have friends you could chat with, and it's a beautiful settings for a social gathering. So Murat, that's how I kind of start dancing, and then that's how I made it a little more like a profession. But then, as it happens in other fields, more you expand yourself within whatever you're doing, you start to touch the neighboring fields. Maybe as a dancer, the music becomes a thing that you kind of catch on to. Or as a dancer, you can, you know, come closer to martial arts or something. Or maybe some sports could be actually now very handy for you as a dancer to get involved with. So at that moment that I feel like I maybe have expanded myself enough to ask for the need of combining my previous talents, like making artworks. And I think the connecting part was teaching, and particularly teaching musicality as a tango teacher, is where I was really needing to make drawings for my students to say, like, can you hear the phrase starts and finishes here? Can you hear, can you see in this part of the music the singer is singing, and let's do something to that. And then when the singer is done, then now we could actually do this, you know? So that need to make visualizations of the music call back the painting. And I said to myself, why don't I just actually make proper paintings rather than simple illustrations and drawings on the paper? With the help of millions of colors you have access, and the large size, and you can create customized shapes of Kiki and the shape of Buba, and in the right place in the timeline of a song. So I start making paintings and such. So when those paintings started to happen, then these lectures were born, and that's why we're looking at these slides. Was I able to connect your question to the slides that we're looking at? I hope. Hi. Vega is there. Hi, Vega.
Merhabalar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was gonna be in English, if I knew, I would have invited some American friends. Very interesting. I'm Ega Sankar. I'm the founder of the Atatürk Kültür Merkezi. And that bless Murat is doing an excellent job of, you know, finding very interesting speakers like you. And welcome. You know, my husband and I try to learn dancing. And finally, we agreed that we don't have that God-given talent to separate the rhythm and to move our body with it. So what you're talking is very interesting, you know, to start with the steps, but to start with the music and the rhythm and the percussion and maybe learn to listen to it before you say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, you slide your leg. And so I'm very, very excited by your lecture. And I do hope that you have something on, you know, YouTube or, you know, that kind of teaches this even further to get to this into, you know, to get us understand the rhythm, the melody, and then start moving our body. I mean, this is very interesting.
Yeah, Vega, I can't agree with you more. It is very common that whichever form of dance that you go and take classes for, you will first meet maybe some person that you will deal with, the dance partner, and you will be stepping on each other's toes for a while. That happens. And then the next thing will happen is the vocabulary of the dance, the steps. And how to put your foot here, how to put your foot there, so you don't again step on each other's toes. And so that's the common order of events in someone's learning how to dance. And if you magically pass those lines, because when you think about the feet all the time, you have two, your partner has two, there are 4 feet to worry about. And then if you are going into the leading and following, how to make this person do something with you, and it's really challenging barriers, these, like if you can pass these, then the day comes, you are introduced into musicality. I find it's a little bit sad because I think musicality could be there right off the beginning, like you are pointing out. For example, let's think all together. Your dance shoes that you purchase, and if you dance in them, at one point they get old and you have to replace them. So your dance partners sometimes, your teachers, you know, the dance school that you go to take classes, they also come and go. None of those things will be there to stay, right? I mean, you are also kind of, we are getting old every passing day, and you won't be able to do the same thing that you were doing before. And, you know, I don't want to sound depressing, but sometimes the dance partners come and go. And when we were looking at the first video, I was halfway nostalgic that looking and watching my ex dance partner there. And my previous dance partner was my wife. Yeah. Pardon me? Yeah. So my previous dance partner was my wife. And I know that that was also something that comes and goes. And so the reason I'm talking about this, while everything is so impermanent, except one thing that is quite steady, is the music, right? I mean, the music of tango, especially, it is the same tango that we heard in 1920s and 1910s. I am still teaching those. And in my slides, I was playing a song from Biaggi, 1934. So the music aspect of the dance is quite steady. Therefore, I come back to your comment, Vega, and safely I can say, perhaps starting to dance, whatever field of dancing, but with its music, might be the most steady and most reliable way of starting to dance. And that's what I'm sharing with you a little bit in my slides today. Kiki and Buba are funny assistants to hear the music in ways that you maybe never heard before. And if you could catch yourself nodding your head like this when sometimes the music is very rhythmic, there you are, your body is kicking. And if you find yourself doing sways when you hear someone beautifully singing, you are in the feeling of legato, which is the buba. So I think I should go back to my slides and then continue them, respecting the time here. And then again, we can come back at one point and then receive more questions. Is that okay? Can you give me a thumb up all together? Good, we're in a good place. So I continue to see where we are. We looked at kiki and buba, and I can play a tango song for you. And let's see if you can catch those rhythmic versus melodic conversations in the music. Okay, this is also from 1930s, and you will hear for a while a very kiki-like sound, and then that should really make you wonder when the buba lines will come to correspond. And at one point you might be hearing both of them playing together. See if you can keep your mind busy with that conversation the music is having. It's like a mini meditation for us. From your busy day, now you saw one single slide with about 3 minutes of music playing. And in normal circumstances, listening to some old song can get boring. But if your minds are occupied with kiki and buba, right? I mean, you have a technique of meditating at the moment, like you concentrate on your breathing or whatever the technique you're using in your meditation. At the moment, our mind was completely occupied, I hope, unless you were thinking of what to eat for lunch tomorrow. You were probably thinking of the sharp sounds and the round gestures in the music and how they actually converse. And if you could see, perhaps that's the reason why that I showed these shapes of Kiki and Buba, if you could see these sounds as a shape in your mind, then you are one step closer to finding a gesture inside your body, which is another shape. You know, keeping yourself straight and strong and taking very linear steps when you walk could make you go closer to the staccato of the music, right? And when you hear the legato in the music, which is the buba, and if you say, I'm just gonna relax into this, and then when you find your spine, that is quite round and circular, and all the vertebras are rolling around each other, you find snake-like, octopus-like, squid-like gestures within yourself that could guide you to move with the violin or the singer singing beautifully with the legato, with the buba section of the music. I hope you're able to see the correlation. It turns out the human brain is able to extract these abstract properties from the sound and from the shapes and connect them together, you know? Let's have an experiment together. So I think you should say the word Kiki now. Say it out loud. Good thing that your microphone is off. So make a big sound in the count of 3, 2, 1. Kiki. Let's do it one more time. 3, 2, 1. Kiki. So the sound of Kiki comes a little more from here. K-k-k. It's a little bit like k-k-k-k-k. Yeah, it's a little bit like coughing like. It's completely COVID proof, this exercise, because we're in a Zoom meeting. We can't do this anymore in the real classrooms. But the word buba, if you go ahead and say buba, buba. Buba, it activates your muscles around your lips and your mouth to be more round. Buba. And if you say it one more time, pay attention to how long it takes to say buba. Buba. And Kiki is something very instantaneous. It's something very short and very compressed. Buba is, you know, released and softened and unfolded in some ways. That's why I gave the example of a octopus, you know. So if you could use your hands perhaps for the shape of Kiki, show me like what you could do with your hands for a shape of Kiki. I don't want to influence you, but perhaps one hand is a pretty good Kiki shape. But can you do it with your entire body? Give it a try to see if your body can become very Kiki like. Can you sit a little more Kiki? That's more like sit up, I think, right? Like I don't fit into the screen anymore. I'm sitting up, I'm straight up, I'm in a square, I'm in a cube. I feel a little more like maybe, I don't know, a little bit tighter in my body. Do you feel that? Like, can you feel your abdominals? Can you feel your buttocks to be a little more firm? That's the form of Kiki that you're experiencing inside your body. And I assure you, if you are in this state as you dance with your partner, not only you, but your partner will feel the kikiness from your body, and then she or he will want to be like you. You will inspire someone, or she will inspire you to pronounce this shape more. And my friends, if you are like this with someone, you will probably do kiki-like things, right? I mean, you can't be this and then do that. Like, you need to allow your body to become something so that your gestures and your expressions come from that state of being. Therefore, your steps will be much more staccato, much sharper, much more compact, much more kiki. And the buba, again, it comes with most of the times a relaxation and releasing yourself, and your partner could feel this in the embrace, and she or he could relax in the embrace with you. And both of you being relaxed, you probably wouldn't think about taking another step. You will find yourself staying here now and spending more time together instead of going and doing something. So all of a sudden the steps are gone. All of a sudden the future is gone. What else to do is gone. And what you have now in the sound of Buba is the embrace and relaxation of your own body and relaxation of your partner's body. And that inspires you to stay and cuddle perhaps in the embrace and swirl and, you know, be more round and find a more interesting hug. And all of a sudden your dance becomes more upper body oriented than the step oriented. That's what we are going through so far, thanks to Mr. Curler's work with Kiki and Buba. He is able to make us see the sound, and if we can see the sound as a shape, we could mimic that shape and our bodies become like that sound. So I am going to show you the last form, the last element of the music. The form of the music, this information on the right. have I been sharing my screen? No, I haven't.
No, we don't see your screen.
Okay, now you do, right? Good. I didn't spend 15 minutes without showing my screen, don't worry. So now we're looking at the form aspect of the music, which is actually just means composition. I like the form element of the music very much because it tells me where the things are and when things happen in the music. Here is a graphic, down there is a song again, and has a rondo form, A-B-A-C-A, which is quite a safe form, safe composition. I don't know if you understand what I'm showing here. So this is the beginning of the song, and the beginning of the song starts with the A, and A takes about 30 seconds, this section. And imagine like you're watching a movie. Maybe that's where the characters are being developed. The director is following a particular composition or an opera. And then the B comes, and maybe that will be the place, the location that these characters are actually within. And then the characters could be getting into some kind of dramatic thing could be happening. And then the C could be like something else comes and the story finishes with the people that we began with. I could think of many other examples for this wonderful rondo form. For example, A could be you're at home, and then B, you went to the office and you did your working, and A, you came back home, and C, you went out for a dinner. Or in our case, you went to dance tango with your friends. And at the end of the night, you should come back home, right? One can go further. I can say, how about a sick day? I'm not going to an office. So this is my bedroom. I'm spending time in the first A. And then I drag myself to the, kitchen to eat something. And then I'm exhausted. I come back home. I go use the restroom sometimes in the section C, and then the day finishes with the A. So this is a very common form in art making. And in this song also, we are hearing that musicians tend to group their instruments and their sounds into a meaningful composition. I'm going to play the song to you quickly, and so you can hear only the beginnings of these paragraphs. I'm going to be very quick. I'm going to fast forward, actually, so you only hear the beginnings of the section A. Here we are. Fast forward. Section B. Sounds different. Wonderful. Fast forward. We're back to that sounds exactly the same. Fast forward. That's something very different. Whatever that may be, we end up perhaps one can call this the theme of the song. When you hear this and you say, I know that song, it plays two more times in the song. And what I did is I looked at this song on my computer and then I said to myself, okay, so we have these paragraphs inside the music and every paragraph is made out of sentences. Sometimes this A section could be playing two sentences or maybe one sentence with a comma right in the middle, but it's very symmetric, like whatever you heard, it plays one more time to form one paragraph, like A. You can see inside that paragraph that there are some sentences, we call them phrases. So I put them on a canvas. No matter how simple the canvas started, in time it evolved to find its final shape, where not only the form of the music that is still traceable, you can still see the yellows are there, okay, A is there, and B is the red, and then the C is the purple, good. And what are the circles? Hey, circles are buba, the legato, and straight lines are the staccato. And the gestures high up there, I don't know if you can see the little triangles and little sharp spiky palm trees, like I painted this in Hawaii when I was there. And that represents all the kikis. And look on this vertical line, you can see how they line up. And then followed by the A section, which you heard in the song, that is quite legato. Here's another artwork. Some sections of this song is very legato, very round. And the remaining sections are very staccato. And the very last section, as you can see, on the very right, we call it the variación of the song. It is the combination of kiki and buba, which we have experienced that. And then, of course, a singer at one point will sing, and he usually sings during the legato section, because the human voice is a very legato thing to do, right? This is a very organic sound. I think human voice could be very challenged trying to make staccato sounds like a violin plucking, or bandoneon and accordeon is really like pushing and pulling in, and the piano, for example, could be very staccato. And the structure allows me to have this kind of a painting where you can see the lyrics of the song. And then, of course, today we're only looking at rhythm, melody, and form. These are maybe the most basic elements. But the elements that I missed telling you today are texture, dynamics, harmony, timbre, which is a very important element. And those elements allow me to choose the red versus the blue, or allows me to choose some particular forms, particular shapes inside the painting that describes the texture of the music. Hopefully one another time we could meet. Another artwork, this is again about a meter 30 centimeters wide panoramic, and you could already see the circular shapes versus linear shapes. And here we have a song called SOS by Francisco Canaro. It's a very old song. I can play a section of the song to you. In fact, what I'm going to show you now is the true meeting of an artwork with its music and the dance that was made for it. Does it make sense? It's like a triangle of music that conducts the art, music that conducts the dance. Then the dancers that they dance within the artwork. Is that possible? Are you able to visualize this? So dancers can dance with the music. You can interpret the music in your body. And an artwork can be made out of the music, indeed. But how about the dancing and the artwork? That edge of the triangle. How could we put that together? So what we did is we created a circular version of this artwork on Photoshop, and we put a very strong projector on the ceiling and projected down on the floor. And the left shows you the detail, and the top shows you the entire painting with the red timeline and then the performance underneath. I'll leave you alone with this. So, of course, I don't know what you're seeing. You're probably watching the dance and you're looking at the artwork and you're listening to the music and you're connecting dots together. I'll tell you what I'm thinking. Once again, in a tango feeling, I'm very nostalgic seeing my ex-dance partner, who was my wife. We were together for 10 years and she's from Hawaii. We're still very good friends. In January last month, she and I went back to Hawaii for 2 weeks of work. She's a very good addition also in our family. She's the auntie Michelle with our baby. And so it's so nice to see her in this video. And it was good times. That was a performance in Portland, USA. And yeah, so I think I have a very little number of slides to show, which probably takes 5 minutes. Allow me to do that and then we can have some conversations. If that's okay with you, do you want to give me a thumbs up? Okay, great. So we look at another artwork. Let me share my screen. Here we are, and this is another song from Carlos Di Sarli. And remember this form, ABACA, the Rondo form. This also became an artwork. I think we looked at this, right? Let's take a look at it one more time, because we had a performance about this painting. We captured some of the sections from the painting and projected them on the floor in Stuttgart, the year 2008 or 9 or something like that. And it was a street performance. It was a nighttime street performance. And some coincidences took place. Legato. Staccato. Okay, that's actually the end of my presentation, but it's nice to see this talk. So once again, I think everything that we see, we have different ways of looking at it. When I look at this, when I look at this video, I remember an email I received like 3 years after this performance. That's like, I don't know, 5, 6 years ago or something, I received this email and the person says, "Do you remember the dog that was living with us, you know, in Stuttgart?" And this is like the friends of the tango organization in Stuttgart writing to me. She said, and she says, she passed away and we're having quite a serious funeral for the dog. I think dog is the theme today, because I told you another story about another dog in the beginning of this talk. And this dog died, and then they wanted to make a giant event about it. And then they requested me if I could give the permission for this video to be displayed. So they actually watched this video during the funeral. And so nice to think of that. And Stuttgart has been also very nice to us since the beginning, and I will be going there this year, hopefully, once again. Okay, that is the end of my slides, and I hope that this gave you a chance to connect some dots that we have in our life, music, dance, and art, and perhaps it's an unusual way of connecting these dots today together. But I had a great time sharing the slides with you. I hope you enjoy them as well. In the meantime, I respect the timing, because I live in Switzerland and here is no-no to really stretch things up so much. And I promised Murat that I'd like to do something about an hour, and we started this presentation, this Zoom meeting with you 7:10 in my time, and now it's 8:10, so we are exactly on the hour. But I, of course, I also am very curious if you have questions, and I'd like to help within my ability. I'd like to get to know you a little bit. And we wanted to speak English because Erika was supposed to join us, and Erika doesn't speak Turkish, and we ended up speaking English. Oh well. And we can switch to Turkish if you like, however you feel comfortable, please. You can shoot your questions. Murat'cığım, how are you doing there? Are we doing okay?
Ben sanat ve müzik journeysinde Türkçesi, iki İngilizce Türkçeyi karıştırdım şimdi. Bizi çok güzel bir seyahate götürdün sanat ve müzikle. Çok eğlendim, çok eğitici ve eğlendirici bir presentation'da sunumdu. Çok teşekkürler Murat. Sorusu olan varsa onları alalım.
I also saw some chats. Bazılarımız bir şeyler yazdı. Tamam.
Ben bir şey söyleyeyim. Biz de mühendisiz. Herhalde şey yapmamamızdan, dans öğrenememizden anladınız mühendis olduğumuzu.
Estağfurullah.
Yani konuşmanız o kadar her günkü hayattan o kadar üstünde, o kadar üst seviyede ki yani soracak bir şey bulamıyorum ama bütün ufuklarım açıldı gibi geliyor. Yani I feel that my horizons has kind of opened up. I've started looking at it in a different way. And I'm really amazed that I have been so enriched.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Murat.
Thank you. You're very welcome.
Wonderful lecture.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Pleasure. If you see an unusual dream tonight, and if you wake up saying like Kiki or something, and that's maybe my work is done here. Something that is maybe planted and makes you see things, hear things differently, and makes you maybe appreciate the music and art in new ways. That should be more than enough for a Zoom meeting, don't you think?
So how long does it take for you to put together that beautiful tango picture with ticks and, you know, with the texture and all that?
Mm-hmm. The painting, you mean, or the painting, right?
Painting, yes.
Yes. So these paintings were done during the downtimes of our travels, because except the pandemic, before pandemic, about 18 to 20 years of constant traveling internationally, and occasionally once a year, we would go back to Hawaii, where my ex-wife was from. And we would just stay there and not work, and you know, stay about a month. So every month that I stay there, I try to make one painting. Sometimes it takes longer than a month. Sometimes some of them never finish. There is a painting here, it's for La Comparsita. It is hanging vertically right now because there's no hope for this one. I don't think it's ever going to finish. Some of them are taking unusually long time. But my attention has been also switching. Now Murat and I, we work on the websites, and within the website works, I am offering a different line of artistic work. And there are some other works that I've been doing with the university in Sweden with motion capture technology. And just shortly to say, rather than making visualizations for the music that is hard to describe, we're working on how to make the movement visual. So we dress up in costumes with the sensors, and then we move in space, and the cameras are able to exactly measure how your hand moves in space and how your head turns. So instead of people see your face, they actually see the movement itself. And so we're working on how to make sculptures out of the three-dimensional data we collect through the cameras and computer. And so the idea is to make the dance touchable, not only visual, visible, but also touchable. You could feel it. So a little bit distracted with those. That's why this painting is never going to finish there.
That's very interesting. I'm sorry, I'm hogging the time, but I'd like to see the comparsita. I guess my wedding.
Yes. Hey, like comparsita is very important for us, you know, like everyone in the United States that I used to live, also in Europe, whenever I tell them that La Comparsita is our wedding dance, and they just cannot believe it, you know. I think we have something to do with tango through our wedding dances. And this painting is made because I had a course about La Comparsita, how to dance to La Comparsita. And I find it very useful because every tango night, most of the countries you go and travel, finish with the La Comparsita. La Comparsita is the last dance. So therefore, La Comparsita is the most danced tango, is the most famous tango, most recorded tango, and most stories attached to La Comparsita. So I decided to make a painting. It doesn't look good, but I'll show it to you. Hold on. You can see the circles and staccatos, and you already have a pretty good idea. And there is, where is it? It's there. There is the A section, B section, A section, C, and A section again. This is a rondo. Now, I'm so happy to know that you actually have a pretty good idea looking at this artwork. You know what it means. Because most people look at artworks and they say, yeah, I have an orange couch in my house and this would fit really nice on top of it, you know. But in reality, more you know about the art and more you know about the music, more you get involved in it, and more you involved you are, more you identify yourself, and then you actually come to appreciate it more. So, and you are already through this meeting completely involved with Kiki and Bubba.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Somebody else has a question. Burja had a question, I think.
Oh, I didn't have any question, but I'd like to extend my appreciation for this event. I didn't expect any of these learnings this morning, to be honest. And I myself, well, dancer in heart. I was a ballerina when I was a child. Then I took some classes in Los Angeles and in England. I think I'm a very good dancer, but I think I'm a rumba, the round shape. I'm very round. So, my soul is very kicky, but I think my body is very rumba. At this point,
so you should be rolling so much better, actually. It's a good thing.
I'm rolling and rolling. I'm very round. But I'm very amazed with your paintings too, especially your artwork from Hawaii. I wish you had an art exhibit in Los Angeles in Atatürk Kültür Merkezi. Next time you visit Los Angeles or America, I believe Vega and AKM will be very appreciative if you can, you know, do some exhibit and meet with the community in Los Angeles and actually in Southern California, let's say.
Sounds
and,
beautiful.
So I'm looking at Murat Buyuran right now. Murat, you should arrange something with...
He's a world traveler. He will stop by Los Angeles.
Well, anyways, thank you very much. And well, today is March 6th, very close to International Women's Day. So I want to salute all the brave women in my life, specifically Vega. She's my mentor, peer, my sister, and a good friend. And I see Efes Hanım, Sema Hanım, Feridecim, hello. And Fatma Hanım is here, and I don't know who else is. Hatice Hanım here, and Pelincim, happy International Women's Day. And Murat Bey, thank you very much. And greetings from a sunny Los Angeles. And greetings from me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us, Burcu.
Murat Bey, may I have a question?
Please. Absolutely.
There was a very nice program this morning at this very hour, but I was able to catch. So if you ever come back, I enjoyed the presentation very much. If you ever come back, would you like to give us a little bit examples from Carlos Gardel?
Absolutely.
I think that's one of the founders of the tango music, if I'm not mistaken. I'm sure you have a lot to say about him.
Absolutely. Yes.
Enjoy your program very much.
Thank you so much for joining. Hey, Los Angeles is a potential place for me to pass by within the United States on my way to Hawaii, which I go every year for the last 17 years, including this year. I mean, I left my wife and my baby so that I could go to Hawaii to do some of my rituals, which means a lot to me, and my wife completely understands that. It's a family connection that I have there. And honestly, on my way back from Hawaii to Europe, I had a flight that arrived Los Angeles on a Tuesday night, and the next flight was Wednesday afternoon. So I don't know what kind of an idea that gives you, but we decided to run workshops in the morning of Wednesday, and we called them layover workshops. Literally, like, I left the airport and I rented the organizer's location, and then I slept, and the next day in the morning we woke up early, went to the dance studio, and we were able to squeeze in two workshops on musicality. It was so tight that I didn't even have chance to call my dear friend Murat to say, hey, should we get a coffee or something? There was no time. So we just ran those two workshops, and the attendance was very nice. People were very excited about it. And then right after the class, I said, thank you for coming to the class. And then with the luggage in my hands, we just took a taxi to go to the airport and caught the flight to come back to Zurich. So that's a kind of a quick way of passing by LA. But why not next time, next year? Maybe we could do a few extra days in LA. My organizer in LA is a fantastic person. I like to see her and work with her anyway. And then we could combine that with a small gathering together.
I'm excited for it.
That's what we would love to host you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions for Murat? Thank you so much for joining us, Murat.
Thank you for inviting me.
It was an awesome, wonderful day.
This was your initiation, so we're so grateful that you put together this opportunity for us.
Thank you.
And Murat.
Merhaba Fatma. Tamam.
Merhaba.
Fatma jet gibi geldi ve gitti. Ve 70 yaşında olduğunu söyledi. Yalan söylüyormuş gördüğümüz kadarıyla. 70 yaşında değil yoktaşı. Mümkün değil. 58-59 gibi bir şey gördüm ben orada.
Teşekkürler. Yani büyük bir alkış hakikaten Murat Bey o kadar olacak.
Sağ olun. Sağ olun.
Teşekkürler.
Çok teşekkürler.